Thank you. Thank you. by the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my light to them? Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my home. I, the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them, my hand will save. Finest bread I will provide, till their hearts be satisfied. I will give my life to them. Whom shall I send? Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I if you lead me, I will hold your people in my heart. I will hold your people in my
El Shaddai, El Elyon Adonai. Age to age, you're still the same by the power of the name. El Shaddai, Echam Kana. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the memorial service celebrating the significant life of Reverend Robert Rupert Forsyth, born on the 30th of May 1954 and sadly passed on the 27th of April 2022. I love the quote. It says, "I came, I saw, I conquered Julius Caesar." Let us please stand as we open up in prayer. Father, this good morning, this good afternoon, we come before you. We bow our heads in reverence and love and mercy as we remember a great life, a wonderful life lived. May your strength, your love, your blessing rest upon these people, we pray, and in particularly the family this afternoon, we pray, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to sing Amazing Grace. We will be led. Let us all sing together. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. You may please take your seats. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Pastor Basil Panai. I am an ordained pastor of the Apostolic Faith Mission Church of South Africa. And it is my great privilege and pleasure to be with you on these very sad, on this sad moment. I want to read Psalm 23. This afternoon, I have found it to be a psalm of solace, a psalm of encouragement, a psalm that points us to where Robert is. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in paths of righteousness, for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 23, my good friends, is a psalm by King David in the Old Testament. And David had a deep relationship with God. And David alludes to life eternal. That last verse speaks to us, especially for those of us of the Christian faith, of life beyond this life. And David alludes to it, saying he will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This afternoon, my brother and my sister, Reverend Robert Rupert Forsyth, what a great man. But everything that is going to be said this afternoon must be taken within the framework of his love for God. He was a man who loved God deeply, loved God faithfully, loved God with an earnestness. You could not come around Robert and be in conversation with a man, whether it was about history or culture and many of his interests, and not hear his deep and abiding love for God. Death has once more invaded our ranks, my brother and sister. But we know that there is life beyond in Christ Jesus. Robert was an awesome father. Many times I would sit with him and he would share with me how proud he was of his two children, Robert and Sarah. A man who loved his family deeply. A friend, he loved art, he loved heritage, he loved culture. He loved God and he loved Africa. He was always ready to improve himself and grow and learn. He kept learning right up until the day of his death. And I want to share a few things that stand out for me about his life. The first thing was that I believe that Robert loved God deeply and he loved Jesus and the Holy Spirit. And he was certainly a visionary. I don't know if you've walked around Misty Hills and Kedar and the restaurants that he built with his family. And you look at the vision this man had. This is a massive facility. I have one of the elders of my church, and we were just commenting on the vision that it took to accomplish this. The Bible says to us in Proverbs 29:18, where there is no vision, the people perish. And I would pray today that as you think of Robert and the life that he lived across all of these areas, he indeed was a polymath. A man that knew a lot about many things. But it all started with vision. Imagine all those years ago coming here and seeing this ground where there was nothing built. He saw vision. He saw the very hall that you are seated in today as we celebrate his life. You walk around and you see the impact he had on people's lives. He had a vision to build. But not only things and buildings, he had a vision to build people. Many of you here have been touched by his life, and he continues to build, and many of the lessons that he taught has been left with us today. Wasn't it wonderful arriving and seeing the excellence of the staff, Adele? It was marvelous. We arrived and everything was catered for, the cameras for those that are overseas, and we are streaming. I always joked I never wanted to be a televangelist, and here we are today because of streaming. But the excellence, the hall is prepared. The food is ready. Someone taught those people that, and it took a vision to take people forward. And I want to encourage you today that if you look at the life of Robert Forsyth, you would be encouraged to be a person of vision. The second thing that stands out as a marked characteristic of the man was Robert was bold. He was as bold as a lion. I remembered sitting with him sometimes. I'm of Greek descent. My parents come from Cyprus. So, you know, us Greeks, we are loud, and on we go. And he said to me, Basil, he says, you know, me and Pastor Tony have been talking about you. I said, that's a lovely thing, Robert. Thank you. And he said, you know what you need a bit more of? I said, tell me. He says, you must be bold. A bit more boldness, he said. And you know, that's one thing when you hear that being said from someone who is not bold. It is another thing when someone who is bold tells you to be bold. Because you need to look at their life and see the way they live, the way they approach life. And especially for us who call ourselves Christian, we must be people who have a vision. We must be people that are bold. We serve a great God, a big God, a marvelous God. Romans 8:31 says about this boldness, if God is for us, who can be against us? That is indeed the way that Robert lived his life. With many challenges, was born in Zimbabwe. And I know that he loved Africa and he loved Zimbabwe. And you think about the journey from that country to this, to build all of this, the challenges, the obstacles. But he had a boldness in God. And he had a boldness to say, you know what? God is with me. Who and what can be against me? Indeed, something that we can learn from. Robert also was deeply creative. Genesis 1:1 talks to us right in the beginning of the Bible where we encounter God for the very first time. We don't encounter him as the Father God. We find that out in the New Testament. But the very first time we read of God, we encounter him as this great creative God, this great creator. God is a creator, and the Bible says that we are made in his image. Mankind is the only creature, by the way, all across the world that has the ability to create. The ability to create. And it sets us apart from the animal world. We create language. We create music. We create history. We create art and culture. Beautiful things. And Robert certainly carried that. You should take time and walk around the facilities. And you will see the deeply creative little nuanced touches to the facility. It was all in the mind of a man. Those beautiful giraffe archways as you enter the building was his idea. The gates with the lights. You walk into the reception area and you look above at that beautiful chandelier. It's all creative and a reflection of the God that he served. And as I come to close my part of the service, someone don't say amen right now, would not be apt. Robert, I think the thing that stood out the most about his life for me is that Robert loved people and he loved community. In the Bible, they ask Jesus, they say, Jesus, what are the two most important ways to live life? And he says, it is to love God, this creator God who gave you life, to find your purpose and your meaning in him, and then to love people. And I know that he loved his family deeply, Adele, Sarah, Robert, and Colleen. But he loved you that are seated here today. You have not come because of the pastor. You're not here because of the building. You're here because he touched your life in a meaningful and deep way. And he loved people. He loved people as a reflection of his love of God. He loved you, and that's why you're here. Love means everything in life. This is what Jesus teaches us. Love is the best way to live life. And that's why you are here this afternoon. He loved his God. He loved his family deeply. And he loved you this afternoon. Indeed, we celebrate the significant life of Reverend Robert Rupert Forsyth. this afternoon as we continue with the service, I would like to call up Pastor Tony Louch to continue.
Such a paradox, because on one hand we weep, and yet David the psalmist wrote and he said, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. So it's paradoxical. We cry, we weep, and Jesus wept. He cried over Jerusalem. He cried when the word came from Mary and Martha that his friend, good friend, Lazarus, had been dead 4 days. The shortest verse in the Bible is, and Jesus wept. So be aware that there's a place to weep, but there's also a place to rejoice, because we rejoice. I mean, we had yesterday, and God bless every one of you for coming today. I know we have a lot of VIPs and people who have come a long way, particularly from areas like Cape Town. Colleen and her friend have come all the way from California. But God is here. Jesus said, wherever two or three are gathered together, I'm there in the midst. And I want to tell you, he's here to bless you. I think in the 58 years I've known Jesus and preached the gospel, yesterday, I know you couldn't all be there, but we had the most incredible funeral service I've ever done. We all participated. We buried him with dignity. His mortal remains are there. But the Bible teaches very clearly that when you know Christ, to be dead is to be present with the Lord. So the moment he passed, in that instant, he was in the presence of the Lord. Later on in the resurrection, his body will be raised. And the scripture says we will see Jesus and we shall be like him. 33, Jesus was when he died. Good looking, strong from being a carpenter. No more aches and pains, no more tears. You know, I often laugh, I don't really, but when... You know, when a husband or a wife says, I can't wait to be reunited with you in heaven. And the Pharisees came with a story and they said, there was a woman and she was married to this one and that one and that one and that one and that one. In the resurrection, whose wife shall she be? Jesus said, you don't understand. In heaven, you're neither given in marriage or married. For some of you, that's good news. For some of you, it's... You say, well, why not? How come? Well, because you'll be so enthralled with the Son of the living God. When I read the book of Revelation, which I've read many times, God is not cheap. There are 12 foundations of emeralds and sardius and beautiful foundations. The streets are paved with gold. And out of the Lamb of God, there flows a eminent eternal light. You and I aren't going to have to go and sleep and rest. We're going to be so focused on that one who came, who preached, who proved by word, deed, and resurrection that he was who he claimed to be. He said, I am that I am. Before Abraham was, I am. Somehow in the mystery of godliness, the triune God came together. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. And you're a Trinity, you're a spirit, you have a soul, you have a body. He came to earth to redeem us from the curse that Adam and Eve had brought upon the earth. We were all born DOA, dead on arrival. From the moment you and I were born, we begin to die. I want to encourage you, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord, it's imperative that you thank him for dying for you and inviting him into your life. Robert and I go back 48 years. He and I started a church together. Many of you don't know this, but he was one of my associate pastors. He was the one who had the vision to start that church that you may have seen on the highway called New Life Church. It was he who got the architect. He who oversaw the building. We worked together. And you know, in 48 years, we had a lot of debates. But we never, ever had a fight. He was more than a friend to me. He's the best friend I've ever had. The Pharisees said this, our fathers ate manna in the desert, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven. Then said Jesus unto them, Moses gave you bread, but I came from heaven, and I and the bread of life. For the bread of God is he who comes down from the heavens and gives his life for the world. I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall eat and never hunger. He who believes on me shall never thirst. He's the bread of life. The water of life, he said, I'm the good shepherd. I lay down my life for the sheep. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me shall never perish. I've believed in him for 58 years, and I have no doubt. I'm just sorry Robert went before me. He was supposed to bury me. But instantly, he's in the presence of the Father. We just come today to memorize and memorialize and sing his praises, but we've come essentially to honor the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm going to close with, I was going to read a little more, but I want to close in a way I always close, because although I am a pastor, I am more of an evangelist, and my calling and the calling that Robert endorsed and shared, many a time when we shared Jesus Christ with friends and acquaintances, many professors, many learned men and women, he would always jump in with something supernatural to add to whatever I was sharing. But we both agreed and believed. I'm going to tell you one very short story. One night, we were going to Broadacres. And he knew I was struggling to walk. But he had a sense of humor. So he parked as far away as he could. And as we kind of made our way to the venue at Broadacres, we came across a man. was standing outside his car, and we talked to everybody. It turned out this man was about to commit suicide. And we had the privilege of praying with him there and then, and he invited Jesus Christ into his life. You say, or I say to you, are you ready? Yes, you are. For we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. There is none righteous, no, not one. He was the only righteous one, and he willingly laid down his life for you and for me, and rose again from the dead to give you eternal life. I used this illustration yesterday. We had a glorious time. But I used this as an expression. It's a gold ring with a cross on it. One of my late friends gave his life. If it's God calling, we'll answer. Otherwise, turn off your cell phone. But when that man handed out, his son gave me this as a memorial. I believed him because we were good time friends. But until I reached out and I took that ring and put it on my finger, it was not mine. And I want to tell you today, young and old, until you thank God and thank Jesus Christ, he says, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. If you hear my voice, open the door and I will come in. I want to assure you, you qualify. For you're a sinner and I'm a sinner. Receive Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. I'm going to give you that opportunity. I promise you, he wasn't ashamed to die on the cross. But I'm not going to ask anybody to come out here and declare your faith. I'm going to do something very simple. And because we have such a large audience here, gigantic, I've never seen this many people in the Pelindaba before. I'm going to ask you, if you want to pray and invite Jesus Christ into your life, I want to pray with you and for you, right where you're sitting. So I'm going to address this section of the audience on my very far left here. If you are willing to pray and invite Jesus to come into your life, I want you to just raise your hand and put it down. Raising your hand will do nothing, except it'll indicate to me that you want to pray and receive Jesus. So those on that side, is there anyone who says, yes, preacher, I'm ready. Thank you, thank you. God bless you. Put your hand down. Thank you. Now I'll come to this section here. If there's anyone here, please, just simply raise your hand and thank you, thank you. God bless you. And in here, I can't see the light, but anyone in here, ready, just raise your hand, put it down. You're not joining a church. You're simply going to give your life to Christ. Is there anybody in this section? And I can't see, so I'll just say, praise the Lord, amen, God bless you. And on this side, and right over to the far end, anyone on this side who says, preacher, I need to pray today and ask Christ into my life. Anyone on this side? Oh, God bless you. I see your hand. Those of you raised your hands, stay where you're seated. We're going to pray a prayer out loud to God, not to me, but to the Father. And I'm going to ask every born-again Christian here to join them in this prayer. We're going to pray out loud. God is not afraid or nervous. You can pray out. The Bible says, shout unto the Lord with a voice of triumph. So as you pray this prayer, pray it to God and simply say this after me. My Father and my God, I confess Jesus Christ as my Lord, my Savior, and my God. Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die and to rise again from the dead for my sins and to give me eternal life. I thank you, Father, for the free gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, my Lord. Amen. Now I just want to pray for you. Father, I do pray for those many who raised their hands, and maybe some of you didn't raise your hand, but you prayed that prayer sincerely from your heart. Father, I pray for these folk who've gathered here today. What an honor. What a man that they've come to honor. But I pray, Father, for those who are here and prayed that prayer, that from this day on, they may know the joy of the Lord that addeth no sorrow with it. So we have a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to live and a time to die. The Lord bless you, strengthen you, and enjoy this day. We celebrate it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor Tony. We are now moving over to the part of the service, the eulogy, and I would like to call Sarah Forsyth up to come and share.
Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? Firstly, I'd like to explain why I'm in this very yellow dress. If you sort of know me, you know that I love black, and I actually always wear black. But my daddy has told me a few times over the years that when he died, he wanted me to wear a bright yellow dress with a bow on it at his funeral. Daddy, I'm sorry, but on short notice, this was all I could find. But I hope it brings some brightness to the day, because I know in here we all have some very heavy hearts.
You look beautiful.
Yay! My dad always wanted a celebration of his life, and I want to thank you for being here to do that with us. As we thank God that we were blessed enough to have encountered such a righteous man.
Amen.
My dad always, he was born on the 30th of May, 1954, in Harare, Zimbabwe, to Robert and Helen Forsyth. He grew up in Bulawayo and ventured to the United States in his youth to become a pastor and share the miracles of the Lord and God's word with everyone. Everything he did in God's reflection. My father was a great man whose presence could be felt immediately. Anyone who spoke to him or encountered him knew that he was no ordinary man. He was born with a knack for business and a nose for sniffing out gold. He told me many stories of how he became a businessman from a very young age, selling things at his sister Colleen's dance recitals, or going on a family holiday and transporting magazines from Zimbabwe to South Africa that weren't quite illegal in South Africa at the time, and made quite a pretty penny. He understood business from the get-go and always believed that money was not a problem. Something I remember him saying was, money isn't everything, but it's up there with oxygen. Yes. His mother asked him when he was a little boy, what do you want to be when you grow up? And my father said he was going to be a millionaire. And she said to him, well, you're going to have to learn how to read and write. And he said, what do you think secretaries are for? There was no limit for him because he understood what the book of Philippians meant in the verse, The same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his riches and glory, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. He knew that no wealth of his came from any other but God. He would talk about how God is the richest of all and say, why would I insult him by thinking that he can't supply me with what he has planned for my life? And God unfailingly supplied him because of his faith. My father let absolutely nothing limit him. He marched with his head held high through every single battle, every painful circumstance he would turn into opportunity. And everything that burnt, he would make rise like a phoenix and create and implement a vision far greater than before. We keep pushing, he would say. There have been numerous times when structures on our properties have fallen in flames. And he always replied he would build something far bigger and better. And he always did. Last year, our family home burnt to the ground. And I remember I held my daddy's hand as we silently gazed upon the cabinet glass and the windows exploding. And we watched together everything my parents had collected, everything that they had ever had, dissipate in flames. And I remember feeling calm, only because my father was standing next to me and I knew exactly what he was thinking. I'll build something bigger and better. Nothing could disturb him. His philosophy of life always shone so overwhelmingly bright, and his faith was unshakable. I didn't tremble when my home burnt. I stood tall like my dad, and I knew that it didn't matter. I didn't need a physical home. I didn't need things. You can build another. You can fill it with memories. But you can't get your dad back. My daddy always said that he couldn't read and write properly when he was younger. But in his late teens, he sat down to read the Bible, and from that minute on, he never stopped reading. He couldn't put a book down. And he would read multiple at a time, biblical, philosophical, historical, financial, and the list goes on. And he said he would learn until he died. He was a wealth of knowledge like no other. His love for history is something most of us cannot help but think of when we think of him. He loved African history and was passionate about reviving the stories of our lost African heroes. His love and service for Africa is undeniable, and you can see it all around us. He had a very, very fierce passion for the environment and wildlife. He restored wetlands. He rehabilitated the environment. He had a love for trees, a deep, deep love for trees. He has planted over 100,000 trees in his life. And hundreds of thousands of trees and plants have been propagated because of him. And he had a goal to plant 500,000 trees before he died. And I always said to him, if he was going to plant 500,000 trees, I was going to plant 1,000,000. But Daddy, I will plant 1,400,000 indigenous trees for you. And each one in your name. And together we will propagate millions. He told me that he expected his children to be far greater than he was and do far more, and I asked the Lord how. How do I even begin to compare to such an incomparable man or do things like he did? The greatest man I've ever encountered, and many of you can say the same thing. You have befriended and feasted with kings. You have served as wise counsel to countless. You have built an empire and helped so many communities. To emulate you will be my constant goal, and I will march to make you proud with sword in hand and your name carved into the back of my shield. The legacy my father leaves behind is a mountain, one that he so thoughtfully and intensely visualized and brought to fruition What vision, what faith, and what accomplishment. He knew where everything was placed. Each pot, each badge, each detail. And it demonstrated what passion he had. What focus was on his mind while he placed each brick of his vision on top of the other. I've seen my dad cry many times. He did not fear shedding tears. One thing about these tears was that they were not about pain. They were always tears of love or beauty. He wept at God's grace, something so inconceivable that when he spoke of it, he was overwhelmed. My father was a kind and compassionate man who never had a bad word to say about anyone. A man who would so givingly love those around him, who would defend and fight for his companions, who would give and give to others. I want so badly to kiss your face and touch your beard and play with your long hair. And oh, what I would give just to rub your back a little longer or listen to a story a little more closely. I don't know how I'll walk through any garden without shedding tears for you. If only I'd asked for a tree's name or another fact about the war. You are my absolute person, Daddy. I've always been a daddy's girl. We always walked and sat hand in hand. Lunch, dinner, business meetings, anything. Our love did not hide. There was no way I could hold back my love for him, nor him his love for me. My daddy, my guide, my counsel, my person. I don't know how I'll go on the same without you, Dad. But I know that I have to keep moving. It's not just what you would have wanted, but it's what you would expect. And he would expect us all to hold our heads up to the light and smile with pure joy because he was in our lives and because we knew such a man. He would expect us all to push forward. On the day of my father's passing, one of his very good friends said something to me that I think my father would have liked very much. He said, "The king is dead. Long live the queen." I love you, Daddy. Thank you for being mine.
Thank you, Sarah, for those beautiful words. I'd like to call up Robert Forsyth Jr., Robert's son, to come and share.
Hi, everyone. Good to see so many familiar faces. I wish my dad could see it, but unfortunately, he's gone. And I know today you all know his story. The wonderful gifts and amazing things he's made for each and one of you. But I just want to tell you about my dad. It's my dad. As you can tell, he loved me enough to give me his name. So I'll make good use of it. He always had a smiling face about him. Loved his cream, even though we told him not to. Loved his TV, his series. The way he just looked after the dogs, was always there for them. He was the big man I came home to. And I'm gonna miss him every day. But he's in the hands of the Lord, and I'm grateful that he's there. It's not gonna be long, but it's gonna be to the point. I love you, Dad, and it's sad to see you go, but it's great to have everyone else here. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert. I'd like to call up Colleen, Robert's sister, to come and share with us.
Hi. Well, look at that face. Look at that smiling, joyful face. I just adored my baby brother. I think it always amused my sister-in-law that she'd say, "How, you want to know how your baby brother's doing, what he's up to?" He was always my baby brother. He came into my life when I was 6 years old. And such a joy. I was so proud. When I heard that my mother had a baby boy, I ran down the street telling everybody. I went and knocked on all the neighbors' doors. We lived in a place called Salisbury in Rhodesia. And they all opened the door. I said, "My mommy had a baby boy. It's my baby brother. It's my baby brother." I was so happy. And then when she brought him home, we had a beautiful English pram. You remember those big prams? And I used to push him around in the neighborhood, and people would come and say, "This is my baby. This is my baby." I was so proud of the fact. And when I was about 10, we moved from Salisbury to Bulawayo. And another thing is, a few years ago, my brother said to me, "You know, we were very fortunate to be brought up in a family that loved and nurtured us and gave us opportunities to become successful. My mother was very sure that we were going to get to the top, and she was going to do everything to get us there, and she patted us on the back and told us how wonderful we are." She said it so often, I think we began to think we were just smashing. We were the best there was. Nobody could beat us. Because that's what she told us, right? So it's important that parents lift their children up and give them courage and give them hope. And I'm sorry, I just have to, this whole story has discombobulated me completely. This is my baby brother, and I expected to go way before him, right? And what a wonderful man. He brought my father, my mother, and me to the Lord. He brought the three of us to the Lord when he was a young, young man, when he worked with you, my pastor. And he was just incredible. He didn't mind where he preached. He'd preach anywhere. He couldn't go anywhere without praising the Lord and telling people about the Lord and bringing them to the Lord. When I vividly remember my mother sitting in front of her dressing table. My mother had this beautiful old-fashioned dressing table like women had in those days, an antique one, and she put on her makeup. And Rob was about 10 years old at the time, and he went up to her and he said to her, "Mom, do you believe in free sex?" My mother almost fell on the floor. She said, "Most certainly not." And he said, "Well, how much do you charge?" My mother never knew what to do with my brother. He had a sense of humor like no one I know. Can you imagine that? Did you ever hear that story? That was your dad. And my mother was a bit horrified and lost for words. Another time, when she was in front of the mirror, she was always in front of the mirror, like me, putting on the face, right? He said to her, "Don't ever worry. When I grow up, I'm going to become a millionaire, and I'll look after you for the rest of your life." And he did. What he promised, he actually did. There was nothing small about Rob. He was big in every way, right? And he had dreams. incredible dreams, and he made them happen. He said to me, "You know, Colleen, God gave me the gift of being a visionary. Vision." And he had visions, and he could see, and he knew exactly what God wanted him to do. And he was my hero. He was my little hero. Big hero, not a little hero. A big hero. And he came to this property. He said, "I want to take you somewhere, Colleen. I want to show you this property that I'm going to buy." I think the Hare Krishnas owned it at the time, right? Well, they were a messy lot. I don't mean to put them down, but that it was squalor here. Huh? Yeah, yeah. You've never seen a place like it. And he comes and he said to me, "See here? I'm going to build a restaurant." And I said, "Oh." He said, "And a big one." And he said, "Behind the restaurant, I'm going to build a hotel." And I said, and he did. He did exactly what he said he was going to do. And look at this beautiful place that he created. Such vision. Such an incredible man. Nothing small about him, that's for sure. Let me see. I do have notes and notes. But I love him, and I can't believe he's no longer with us. But I know he went directly to the Lord. And when he arrived there, the Lord opened his arms to him. He said, "Welcome, good and faithful servant." Because my brother had been a servant. He had the heart of a servant. And he gave so much, so much to so many. What an amazing, amazing individual. And I know, I rejoice in the fact that he's seeing my mother and my father and the friends that were brought to the Lord, and that one day his family will all see him and we'll all rejoice together. And one thing I'll say to you is my brother had such a wicked sense of humor. He laughed about everything. He just laughed about everything. And as Sarah said, when I found out the house had burned to the ground, I said, "Rob, that's terrible. What are you going to do?" Oh, he says, "I'm going to rise like the phoenix from the ashes and build something bigger and better." And I just said, "Wow. Isn't that something? What a man. What a man." So my baby brother, he's now singing and laughing amongst the angels because he made everybody laugh every time he called me. I called him, or he called me, once a week, every week. Now, I'm going to so miss these phone calls because he was an uplifting man, very positive. He always had something positive to say, and he'd lift me up, and he'd make me laugh. Everything was funny. He had a funny sense of humor. He'd laugh in the middle of a tragedy, and I'd go, but he got through it. Such a beautiful sense of humor, and such a loving, lovely man, and a very generous man with his time, with his love, with his money. He helped more people than I think you ever will know because he did it in secret. He never was egotistical about what he did for people. He just gave from the heart, and God saw it all. So this is my baby brother, and I thank you so much for coming to see, to hear about him. Until we meet again, darling.
Thank you, Colleen. We are now going to listen to a piece by George and Rihanna Pretorius called Pier Jesu, and you can look on the screens as we just commemorate and celebrate this wonderful love. What a beautiful piece. Many people from all over the world have sent emails and their stories and tributes about Robert's life, and I'd like to call up Amanda Olson to read some of those for us.
First one I'm going to read, can you all hear me at the back, is from a gentleman called Shane Norwood, and he is a family friend who lives in Morocco. I made a joke one time when Colleen went to the Taj Mahal with her brother Robert Forsyth. I said, tell Robert, he's only supposed to look at it, not to buy it. Robert was my friend for 43 years, and the things I will cherish the most about him is his laugh, his great rolling helpless eyes weeping mirth, and his irreverent wit. I knew a different Robert, a man gifted with wisdom and vision, of deep faith, but worldly sensibilities, and possessed of urban charm and charisma in equal measures. Maybe I saw him with different eyes. He was many things to many people, but to me, he was my friend. We were not always in philosophical agreement, and I don't share his faith, but it didn't make any difference, at least not to me. We went on some memorable trips together. You could not wish for a more congenial and hospitable companion. I was privileged to watch and share in some of Robert's stories from the early days before Mulder's drift. I saw his will, his ambition, his astonishing accomplishments, and his deep love for what he was doing. Maybe that was his secret. He loved Africa, loved its history, and he cared for its heritage, and it shone through in all his works. I saw how he carried himself with dignity and humor, and humility that wasn't feigned. One occasion comes to mind when there was a big conference at Misty Hills and we were wandering around, and one of the delegates asked Robert, what did you do here? And Robert said, I work here. He didn't say, I own this or I built this. He said, I work here. It's a telling statement. Robert didn't get it all his own way, just by the way. He got dealt his fair share of bum hands and affairs of the heart, and the inevitability of loss affected him as they affected us all. But his innate strength and confidence and his unfailing positivity carried him through where a lesser man might have failed. When I first heard the news, I wasn't sad, I was angry. Angry that such a titan could be taken in such a senseless and pointless way. But I'm sad today. We all take comfort after our own fashion, and mine is in the fact that he did what he set out to do. He cared for those he loved, and he leaves behind lives, human and otherwise, that would and could have been very different without him. He leaves his beloved Africa a better place. Robert Forsyth was a man, and he wasn't afraid to die, just as he wasn't afraid to live. He was my friend. The next reading is from a gentleman called Michael Podlinski. He's a friend and a speaker, and he lives in Singapore. I lost one of my best friends last week who lived in South Africa. Robert was a godly and loving man, a consummate entrepreneur, and a true friend. Robert has been my friend and mentor, whom I've admired for 3 decades. He was a true visionary and creator, a museum curator, and a master builder, a patient man, someone who devoted his life to Jesus and the Word of God. I will miss him deeply in my heart. Once I watched Robert looking at a field for over an hour. I approached him and I asked him, what are you doing? He said, I'm visioning the best place for the new hotel entrance, and I'm picturing in my mind cars, coaches, customers, and how they would best appreciate the entrance and their first impression of the property. While having breakfast with him on that property, we heard a loud crash of glassware and crockery in the kitchen. He closed his eyes briefly. He smiled, continued our conversation, unfazed by the event. We'd often go to the movies, and we both liked action films. He bought his daughter, Sarah Ripley Forsyth, for her 17th birthday, I think, a small pig farm. He did this so she would learn the responsibility for livestock and how to manage the workers, including the farm manager. And she'd feel the pain when some of her animals fell ill and died, real life lessons. Robert's greatest legacies were not his hotels, game farms, spas, restaurants, or shopping malls. He saw a local man sitting in a ditch along the roadway selling small copper wire statues that he'd made by hand. Robert had a keen eye for talent and approached the man. "Can you make something bigger?" he said. The man didn't understand at first. The artist just said it would cost more. Robert said, "That's not the issue." He eventually got the man to come and stay at his hotel, giving him a room in a workshop. He sent him to art school, where this artist learned to make full-size sculptures from copper. The man became the number one copper sculptor on the continent of Africa, and today lives in a huge house. On another day, Robert's staff brought in a man who'd been beaten, stripped, and robbed of what little he had. They cleaned him up and gave him new clothes. When Robert found out he had been homeless and jobless for 6 months, but could speak 5 languages, Robert gave the man a job as a guest relations officer, who eventually became the guest relations manager. Honestly, I cry inside when I think that I will not chat again on Earth. But my joy is in my firm belief that Robert and I will be speaking face to face again in heaven when my turn comes to depart this planet. It was an honor to know Robert Forsyth, his loving wife Adele, daughter Sarah Ripley Forsyth, and their son Robert Jr. I will miss my friend's laugh, smile, and zest for living. Robert brought joy to my life and the lives of hundreds who had the privilege of knowing him. To his family and friends, may Jesus bless you and grant your heart peace during this trying time in your lives. The next reading is from Martin Dunford. He's in Kenya. He's a business associate and a close, longtime friend. And Martin says, "I met Robert in early 1993 after his trip to Nairobi when he was promoting his services at Audio World. He had dined at the Nairobi Carnival on several occasions and was totally convinced that this was a winning formula for Johannesburg. He invited us to come to Joburg and visit the site for his proposed new carnival. He impressed on us that there was no time to lose and that we had to act immediately. On arrival in Johannesburg a couple of weeks later, I was immediately struck by his vision, passion, and determination. Within the short space of time, Robert had already facilitated our business entry into South Africa by applying for us to acquire FinRand and organizing with the Reserve Bank to repatriate our profits and fees. Basically, it was a done deal before we'd even talked about it. We worked together on the design, and Robert said he would get it built and opened in 6 months. Our team was a little bit skeptical, but he got it done. This is when we learned that Robert had no fear of obstacles, timelines, or failures. He just got things done. He did it again and again with Mr. Hills and Kedar and many other projects. Robert became a close friend, and we shared many experiences and lively discussions. Not only was he an authority on a wide variety of topics with an intellectual and inquisitive mind, but he was also very open-minded and keen to learn about new topics and places and ideas. We had so many laughs together. He had a wonderful sense of humor. Sometimes we could only laugh about some of the situations in our respective businesses and countries, despite the fact that some of them had dire consequences. Then there was Robert the historian. He was extremely well-read. He had an amazing memory and an extensive knowledge of history, culminating in his passion for the Boer War, for South African history, and his wonderful memorabilia collection. I can honestly say I learned so much from him. Robert had a fabulous spirit of generosity, albeit this was sometimes punctuated with harsh rebuttals, since he didn't suffer foolishness or insincerities. But he often championed the underdog and spent enormous time and resources developing and mentoring people in whom he could see positive attributes. He would challenge them to develop themselves and to explore new concepts and even countries. He was always keen to send his team members to the US, to Kenya, to India, or wherever they could gain insights from relevant people. Robert was also the ultimate host. When we or any of our members of the management team visited South Africa, he would go out of his way to entertain us. He would always meet us at the airport, take us to interesting places, venues. He even took us to the World Cup. We would try to reciprocate in Kenya, but it was hard to repay the magnitude of his largesse. Robert has left us with so many memories, experiences, and life lessons. He's improved the lives of so many people, he will never be forgotten. He was very proud of his family and will be sorely missed by Adele, Sarah, Robbie, and Colleen, his closest family, along with many people from different walks of life. Rest in peace, Robert, but be assured that your legacy will endure forever. This is from a gentleman called Mike Dewar. He first met Robert in 1988 in America, and it's entitled A Letter to Robert. Robert, damn you. We had yet to have some more adventures together on this planet. But then you always were a contrary fellow, unbending and uncompromising when you'd made up your mind. More than anyone else I knew, you marched to your own drum. So I'm going to chalk this one up to you on deciding, in a sort of celestial sense, that this was your time to settle the argument we spent so many hours on. What's next? And I know that if there is an afterlife that you so passionately believe in, if the rules permit, you will find a way to send me a message, helping me to prepare the journey of my own mortality. Over the decades, we met across the globe in many places for many, many adventures. You were one of those rare people in my life with whom I could be stuck on a deserted island for months and never run out of things to discuss, explore, laugh, and especially argue about. When we had our boys' trip to California back in 2016, it was just you and me in the car for a week, and there was rarely a silent moment. Some of our topics were so naughty that our uncontrollable cackling nearly caused us to suffocate from lack of oxygen. I remember that as we drove from the Reagan Presidential Library, you had me howling with laughter so much that I had to stop the car for fear of driving off the edge of the mountain road. When I see you again, let's pick up where we left off. With love from Jeff. This is a tribute to Robert from Irene Valentine, his very close family friend and Robert's first wife. Robert and I met in July 1973 when we began attending a lively young church that gathered in the pastor's home in Northcliffe. He was 19 and had just arrived in Johannesburg, having spent a year visiting his sister Colleen in Europe and working in England cleaning milk churns and loading appliances onto delivery trucks. As a teen in Rhodesia, Robert was introduced to Jesus Christ by a friend. Despite struggling with dyslexia, he immediately read the Bible from cover to cover. Thus began his purpose to follow Jesus and his passion with reading. He attended Christ for Nations Institute based in Dallas, Texas in 1975. In 1976, we launched the New Life Tape Ministries with 20 sermons on audio cassette tape. Robert launched Audio World in 1981, initially focusing on audio languages and business education, and later on live seminars and conferencing. Seeking new premises in the early 90s, Robert found the Mr. Hills property for sale by the Hare Krishna Group. This presented new opportunities, including a key relationship with the owners of the Carnival Restaurant. Robert lived what he believed. Most importantly, he trusted God. He trusted in God's unmerited favor. He knew he was a sinner, saved solely by God's unfailing love, demonstrated by Jesus' death and resurrection. Robert was a visionary. He believed his greatest asset was his vision for the future. He cultivated expectancy of good in every opportunity because he trusted in the goodness of God, and he encouraged others in their faith and expectancy. We've all been touched by Robert and Adele's kindness and generosity. They've raised two remarkable children. Both Sarah and Robert's true education has resulted from the example set by their parents, seeking the wisdom of God to live intentionally and purposefully. Life happens so quickly. What and who do we value? In Robert's words, do what is important to you with those who are most important to you. Robert was my friend, he is my brother in Christ, and we know he is now with our Father in heaven. The last reading is from Mike Bailey, Robert's cousin in Zimbabwe. Dearest Adele, Sarah, Robbie, Colleen, and close friends and family, whilst we are not there physically, we join you all spiritually to remember the life of cousin Robert. We also join you in support during your and our period of grief at the sad passing of husband, father, brother, and cousin. I remember so well spending most short school holidays from reps with my cousin Robert back in 1962 and 1965 in their Morningside family home at Bulawayo. It was in these early years that a genuine bond between us was cemented. Even in these tender years, Robert used to fascinate me with his far-flung ideas and plans, most of which I attributed to his fertile imagination. We went our separate ways, the farmer boy and the visionary with erratic contact. Suddenly, the super cousin was building hotels, restaurants, historical collections exceeding the dreams he shared with me at the age of 10. I feel so privileged and honored to have reestablished our childhood bond, and we're into our late 50s, and I got to know him again. His quiet determination, his vision and self-belief, supported by a great sense of humor, generosity and strong support of family, made him the great man whose life we celebrate today. It is always hard for family left behind, but let's be guided by his positivity and determination to move forward even in adversity. All our love to you all from Aunt Lula, Mike, Laurie, and family. Thank you.
Thank you, Amanda. I'd like to now call Adele Forsyth, Robert's wife, to come and give a vote of thanks.
I'm just taking a moment to see that you're all here and to appreciate this turnout today. In everything, give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. And trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not on thine own understanding. On behalf of the Forsyth family, thank you all for being with us today and celebrating the extraordinary life of Robert. We rejoice in a life well lived with this glorious remembrance, and I'm sure you'll join me in appreciation of Sarah's heartfelt eulogy and the moving messages from family and friends. So much has been said about Robert, my partner of 28 years, and I would like to thank our friends and family across the globe for the love and support they have showered upon us. We're eternally grateful for all your thoughts and prayers in our hours of need. For me, Robert's greatest legacy is Sarah and Robert Jr. His greatest desire was for his children to know the Lord, and he believed. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. He so loved his children and was so immensely proud of them, and they are truly worthy of him. He has empowered them with all that they need to lead significant lives of their own, and I pray that the guiding hand of the Lord will be upon them always. I leave you with the words of the Lord that have comforted us. I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. And we know that all things work together for the good to them that love the Lord, to them who are called according to his purpose. Thank you all for being here today. Thank you for sharing with us Robert's legacies. And we would be very grateful if you would join us after the service for some refreshments just outside. Thank you. And thank you, my sister-in-law, for coming all this way. We couldn't have done this without you.
Thank you, Adele. Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes this memorial service in remembrance of Robert Forsyth. Would you please stand as we close off in prayer? Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank you this afternoon that we can remember a wonderful life lived. And Father, we know that Robert is with God, and we would pray your mercy and grace upon each and everyone gathered here, in particular the family and friends that are gathered here today. May they go in the strength, the mercy, the grace, and the blessing of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. That concludes our memorial service.
Same.
by the power of the name. El Shaddai, El Shaddai, El Hamkan.